Hello everyone, I'm Halima Nisa and I'm MABed. Welcome to my class and I'm available through WhatsApp. I'm looking forward for the classes online meeting. Now come to the next relief feature of India, that is the Indo-Gangetic Plains. The interaction of three Himalayan rivers, that is Indus, Ganga and Brahmaputra, and their tributaries resulted in the formation of a great northern plains. In the beginning of about 20 million years ago, it was a shallow basin that was gradually filled with a varied alluvial soil and these rivers brought from the Himalayas. Here the shallow means the little depth. Okay. The Indo-Gangetic Plains broadly consist of three divisions. Again, here the Indo-Gangetic Plains is divided into three parts, that is the western part, the central part and the eastern part. Now first we go with the western part. The western part was formed by the Indus and its tributaries, that is the Jhelum, the Chenab, the Ravi and the Bees and the Satluj rivers, which is flow from the Himalayas. Most of the Indus river basins is located in the Pakistan, leaving minor portion of Punjab and Haryana. Just imagine that the boundary of Punjab and the Haryana, which is the rivers are flow from that and forming the western part. In this region, the Doab features are mostly formed. Here the Doab means the fertile land between the two rivers which form the fertile place and fertile land. Okay, next come to the central part, that is known as Ganga Plain. It extends from the rivers of Ghaggar to the Tosta. This part is mainly spread in the state of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and partly in Haryana, Jharkhand, West Bengal. Okay, here the river Ganga, Yamuna and their tributaries Son, Kosi etc. drain and they form the central part. Okay, next the eastern part. The eastern part of plains exists mostly in a Brahmaputra valley of Assam, and the river Brahmaputra is mainly responsible for its formation. Obviously, the Himalayan rivers which are flowing down deposit their gravel pebble sediments in a narrow belt of 8 to 16 kilometers which form the parallel foot hills in shivaliks. Already we have seen that the Greater Himalaya, Lesser Himalaya, Shivaliks. Now after Shivaliks, the area which is formed by the rivers and which is divided as the Indo-Gangetic Plains. Why it is called as the Indo-Gangetic Plains? So Indo-Gangetic Plains means here the river that is extended from the Himalayas, Indus, Ganga and Brahmaputra. Three rivers are there, those who are flowing and their tributaries which are making the land fertile. So that we are called as that area as the Indo-Gangetic Plains. Why? Because they are forming through the tributaries and the rivers. Get it? Come back to the class, that this feature is known as the Bahaba. Bahaba is the bronze in nature. Small rivers and streams flow undergo through the Bahabar and repair the lower area and form a swampy and marshy region that is called the terai region. And how it is formed means that when the small rivers are flowing and streaming to the underground through the Bahabar and its area is becoming very marshy and swampy. So that's why automatically there, where there is a land which is very fertile and alluvium and plain, there must be the tree will grow with the self service. So that area is called as the terai region. Get it? The region had the thick forest and rich variety of wildlife. Of course there will be. Where there are the forest means there will be. Must there will be the wildlife. However, the migration time to time of India's partition, most of the terai zone has now been cleared and used for agriculture operations and agriculture motives. Fine alluvial plains region are formed towards the south terai region. Why? Because in terai region, the trees which are grown by their self-service, they are not as much as useful. Okay. So, at the time of partition, the India has decided to clear the terai region and use that land, that fertile land, that alluvial land for agriculture. Get it? So, there was no much more like a terai regions, the most of the land are used for the agriculture purpose. So like that, the Indo-Gangetic Plains has divided into three, same as the Himalayas, that is Western, Central and Eastern. The part which is dividing and which is locating in the directions, that on the basis of direction only, the part has named as Eastern part, Central part and Western part. How from the both the sides rivers are flowing and plains are forming, how can we observe and how can we locate that region without names? On that basis only the regions has namely as the Eastern, Western and Central part. Okay, and why it is called as Indo-Gangetic Plains, just we have discussed. In previous class, we have revised and discussed about the relief features of India. At the next side heading to our topic is that the Peninsular Plateau. What is that plateau? How it is formed? We will see. How much area and how much states and how much the coastline of India boundaries are covering with this Peninsular Plateau, we will see in this class. So, that the Indian Plateau is also known as the Peninsular Plateau, as it's surrounded by the sea on the three sides, mainly composed of the hot crystalline hard ignes and the metamorphic rocks. Large amount of metallic and non-metallic mineral resources are found in Indian Plateau. It has broad and shallow valleys with the rounded hills. The topography of a planet is slightly tilted towards the east and the western ghats and the eastern ghats, and from east to west. The edges from the eastern ghats and from the western ghats are respectively. The southernmost tip of the plateau is Kanyakumari. Here this is the roughly diagram to show, to recognize that, to locate that India as a peninsular plateau. Here we can see the some part of India that is which is surrounded by water here. Here the eastern side and the western side, both the sides are respectively as a plateau, and it is started from below the Lesser Himalaya, then the Indian Peninsular Plateau started, and it covers the area Central India, Eastern and Western parts of the India. Okay, so that the topmost southern part of plateau is that Kanyakumari. Here we can see this part of India. So that the Peninsular Plateau consists of two broad divisions, namely as Central Highlands, that is called as Malwala Plateau and Deccan Plateau. Here we can see this, the plateau when it starts from here till end here, that it is divided into two. From the starting of class, we are discussing about the relief and they are divided into three parts, two parts. Now here the Peninsular Plateau is divided into two parts, that is Malwala Plateau and the Deccan Plateau. Over the Deccan Plateau, there is a Malwala Plateau. It is situated here. After the end of the Malwala Plateau, the Deccan Plateau started and it ends at the most top of the Peninsular Plateau, that is at the Kanyakumari. Then, the physical map of India adjacent and south of the Gangetic Plains and the northern of the river Narmada. You can identify and you can notice in your readers, in your test book, that it will show you, see at this picture and observe that how the plateau is started and how many scars of area is covered in the Peninsular Plateau. So that you can identify the Central Highlands prominent plateaus here are there, Malwala Plateau on the western side and the towards the east here, from here to here. Then, in comparison of Gangetic plains, the plateau regions is dry. Of course, the Gangetic plains are formed by the rivers and the slides that we have discussed. And here the plateau are, when compared to the Gangetic plains, the plateaus are very dry land. But they are very useful. Now, how they are useful and how they are playing their role in the physical features of India and how they are most important to the present of physical India, we will see. The rivers are not perennial. The irrigation of the second crop are depend on the deep wells and the tanks. Of course, why? Because there is a no fertile land, that's why the agriculture is dependent on the deep wells and the tanks, which is the water is stored in that. The portion of peninsula plateau lying in the south of Narmada and triangular to the landmass, it is called as Deccan Plateau. Here its shape is like this, that's why it is called as in a triangular way, and it is called as a triangular or the peninsula plateau. It is in this way, so its shape is recognized and called as and known as the triangular way, so it is called as a triangular peninsula land. So it is called as the Deccan Plateau. After that, the Satputra range from the Deccan Plateaus to the north's edge, while the Mahadev, the Kaikumar range and the portion of the Michael range are the eastern edges here, this side. Then the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats and the Nilgiris from the western, eastern and the southern boundaries respectively. This. Okay. The Western Ghats is parallel to the west coast. And structure of the Western Ghat is continuously with a few passes of a gateway to the coastal plains. The Western Ghats are higher than the Eastern Ghats. So, here, these are the Western Ghats and these are the Eastern Ghats. And it is higher than this. Okay. So that the Deccan Plateau region, west, east slope. As we notice in this picture that it is clearly mentioned and it is clearly showing that how the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats are comparing and occupying the land on the Deccan Plateau. Here it's measured, the Western Ghats extends from 1600 kilometers. Western Ghats is also including the Panali, that is in Tamil Nadu, and the Karamandan and the Animodi, which height is 2695 meters of Amala Hills, is the highest peak in the South India. Now come to the Eastern Ghats, that extends from the Mahanadi Valley in the north to Nilgiri in the south. The Eastern Ghats are not continuous. Rivers are originated in the Western Ghats is like Godavari, Krishna, cut out and across the plateau and joining the Bay of Bengal. We know very well this area is covered with the water. Here is the Bay of Bengal and here is the Arabian Sea. Here the rivers which are originated from the Himadri and the Lesser Himalayas, which we have already discussed in our previous class, that are crossing this plateau and joining the Bay of Bengal. That's why when compared to the Western Ghats, the Eastern Ghats are not at most the dry area. It is covering with the river. That's why it is some fertile when compared to the Western Ghats. The average of the Eastern Ghats is rarely exceeds to 900 meters. The highest peak in Eastern Ghats is that and namely as Aromakonda, which is found in Chintapalli, and its height is 1680 meters, which is represent and which is present and located in Andhra Pradesh. Know very well I think where the states are situated, and imagine that when we are listening these Eastern Ghats, Western Ghats and the state names are mentioning, that to understand clearly that how, which states and how they are covering and how they are locating and how they are representing that Eastern Ghats and Western Ghats and how the area of the Deccan Plateau is covering which states. Okay, so that here is a mentioning of a state name to clear that this plateau is covering this much of area and it is located as the Deccan Plateau and on the states which are covering through the Deccan Plateau. So don't be confused, just when you are listening about this all the reliefs, just imagine the political India map in your minds and understand that the points which we are discussing now. Okay, it will be very helpful for you. Now then, come to the hilly area that tracks of the Eastern Ghats. So one of the remarkable features of the peninsular region is black soil formed due to the volcanic activity. As we know that how the mountains are formed, how the reliefs are located before the 2000 million years ago, that this Deccan Plateau is very most important for the black soil which is formed by the volcanic activity. All these lands and all the physical features of world and as well as the India is represented by the tectonic plates. Through that activities, through that movements, now we can find the exact physical features of world and exact the physical features of India. That activity only here mentioning that the presence of the black soil in this area is the activity of volcanic. So have a look on this picture and notice that and observe that how the volcanic eruption is occurred and how they forming the plateau and how they are forming the black soil in this land. Here we have completed that the peninsular plateau. Now we will go with the next topic. After the peninsular plateau, we will go with the next point is the Thar Desert. And we know very well what is desert. Now, the Thar Desert is located in a leeward side of a Aravalli and receives the very little rainfall ranging from 100 to 150 millimeters per year. The desert consists of an sandy plain and rocky outcrops. It occupies the much western Rajasthan. It has an arid climate with a very low vegetation cover. Absolutely and exactly, the desert land which are not having the much water in that, so for that cause only there is no agriculture, there is no fertile soil, that's why there are the rocky outcrops and the very sandy plains are there. So the streams appear during the rainy seasons and disappear soon after. The river which is known as the Luni. Luni is only the river in this area. This internal drainage rivers fill into the lakes and do not reach the sea because of land only. The Indira Gandhi Canal is longest canal in the country which is having the 650 kilometers of vast and water part of the Thar Desert. Hence, the several hectares of desert land have been brought under the cultivation through the help of Indira Gandhi Canal. After all that, we will now go with the next relief of India, that is the coastal plains. The southern part of the peninsular plateau is bordered by the narrow coastal strips longer to the Arabian Sea on the west and the Bay of Bengal on the east. The western coast starts from the run of Kanch and end to the Kanyakumari. It is narrow than the east coast. The plains is unseen and unbroken by the hilly terrain. It can be divided into three parts. Again, the coastal plains are also divided into parts as per the directions and as per the location. When come to the coastal plains, the southern part of peninsular plateau is broadly narrow by the coastal strips along with the Arabian Sea on the west and the Bay of Bengal on the east. The western coast starts from the Rankanj and ends at the Kanyakumari. It is narrow than the east coast. The plain is unseen and unbroken by the hilly terrain. It can be divided into three parts. Here again the coastal plains are also divided into three parts, that is Konkan coast, Kanara coast and Malabara coast. When come to the Konkan coast, this is the northern part It touches the Maharashtra to Goa. Bay of Bengal plains are wide and heavy land surface structure. It stretches from the Mahanadi to Orissa of Kanwe Delta in Tamil Nadu. Okay, it is started from Orissa to Tamil Nadu. It is having a very vast structure and it stretched from the Mahanadi in Orissa to Kaveri Delta in Tamil Nadu. These plains are formed by rivers Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri and very fertile. Why? Because when compared to this side is very very fertile and having the alluvial soil also. Because of the originated of rivers and because of the flow of rivers and because of having this much of rivers in this land. So, when compared to the other side of the coastal plains, this side is very fertile and very Atkal coast in Odisha and then Sarkar coast in Andhra Pradesh and then Coromandel coast in Tamil Nadu. See how the eastern and western coastal plains are divided into three coasts and they are mentioning their state names to remember you that that state is covering that coastal area. Getting here. After that, the Indo-Gangetic plain, these deltas are too agriculturally developed. Coastal zone also enables the rich in fishing resources. Why? Because absolutely, it is having the rivers and it is near to the water body. That's why it is very easy for the fishing and trade also. So, lakes like Chilka in Orissa and Kolleru in Pulikat. So, lakes like Chilka in Orissa and Kolleru and the Pulikat in Andhra Pradesh are the most important features of the coastal plains. Okay, here. Up to here we have completed the coastal plains, how the coastal plains are located and how they are playing their role in the physical relief of India and how they are very useful and compared to the parallel coastal plains which is western and the eastern coastal plains, both are divided into three coasts and situated in which states just now we have discussed. Till here we have completed our just coastal plains. After that, India relief feature is that the islands. We know very well what is island, why it is called as island. Island is a land which is surrounded by the water on all sides and four sides of land. Okay. Think the best example of island is Sri Lanka, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Lakshadweep, Philippines, Japan is also island. Okay, Australia. Getting? Now, come to the class. There are two groups of islands. That is Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which stretch in Bay of Bengal and Lakshadweep Island in Arabian Sea. Both the sides we are having both the islands. These islands are related to India only. That's why we are discussing the India relief feature. Okay. So that's why we are discussing these islands in India relief. Andaman and Nicobar Islands is an evaluated portion of submerged mountain parts running from the Myanmar mountains, which is namely as Arkanyoma. Andaman and Nicobar Islands, how they are formed and how they are emerged and submerged there means they are submerged from the mountain parts running from the Myanmar and they are come to the joint and form an island in the structure of an island which is namely as the mountain which is namely as Arkanyoma. In Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Narcomanda and the Barren Islands are of volcanic origin. As we see that the southernmost tip of India is found in Nicobar Islands called as the Indra Point, which was submerged during 2004 after the tsunami. Now come to the Lakshadweep Island. Lakshadweep Island are of coral regions. It is totally geographic area is 32 square kilometers only. This group of islands is famous for a great variety of flora and fauna. Here flora and fauna means the plants and animals. In these lands, they are rich in plants, different type of plants, and different type of and different varieties of and different species of birds also. So, in conclusion, it is the most important note that there is a vast diversity in the landforms in which the Indian people are live. Of course, from the starting, we are seeing that how the lands are forming and how they are dividing the parts and how they are locating the area and how they are representing the physical area of India, representing the physical future of India in the type of a relief of India. Okay, but some are the irrigated by the mighty rivers flowing from the Himalaya and some by the rain-fed rivers from the Western Ghats and its forests. Many places are located in the river valleys and other in the mountains. Obviously, here the rivers which are originated from the Himadri and the Himalaya, they are very useful for the fertile land and they are using and they are playing the very important role in the physical relief of India and as well as in the agriculture for having the fertile soil. But some are the rain-fed areas, rain-fed rivers. Rain-fed river means the rivers which flow in rainy season only on the basis of a rainy water. So that's why they are called as the rain-fed rivers. So that here we have discussed all about the valleys, all about the shallow area, all about the plateaus, plains, coastal areas, deserts, islands, mountains, how they are representing the India relief features and how they have formed and how they are enlarged, stretched in the physical area. At the end of the class, this is only a class about the India relief in which we have discussed about the landmass, about the physical features and how they formed, when they formed, how and how they are playing their role in the representing of physical features of India. We have discussed about the deserts, islands, coastal plains, Deccan Plateau and mountains, lakes, rivers and southern part of India, northern part of India, how they are coming from north to the south and how they are covering whole area of India and representing the India and how they are helpful in trade also and how they are helpful in agriculture also and how the rivers are originated from the Himalaya and how they are crossing out the area of Eastern Ghats and Western Ghats and how they are connected to the Bay of Bengal and how the islands have formed, volcanic eruption, places situated and how the union territories and how the rivers originated, all these we have discussed in this class. So that and by this we have completed our first lesson, that is India relief features. Thank you.